Morning. Welcome to North Park Church on a great Sunday morning. It might be a little bit cool this morning, but beautiful. And we are thankful that we can be here together. As we think about the life of our church and as we continue to try and move forward together, please make sure you take a look at announcements, whether they be here in the park bench, whether they be Wednesday when they come out with our midweek stuff, whether they be online, whatever it might be, take a look at what's going on and how you might get involved. A couple things I want to make note of this morning. Again, if you look at the back of our park bench, there is a picture. And I want you to make sure that you understood it was, again, a joyful occasion for us to be able to share those Thanksgiving boxes with the family of the students from, again, our Head Start program. And again, families that were thankful, students that were amazed that these crazy people love us. And again, just a great, great thing that we did on Thanksgiving. And so thank you for being part of that. Along with that, don't forget about the end of the month. It's a little different this month. Rather than first Sunday of the month and gathering together for communion, we're going to gather together the Sunday after Christmas, okay, the last Sunday of December. And don't forget there's going to be a food drive. And you can see, again, the announcement in the back of the park bench for that, for the food drive as well. Also, don't forget about the Christmas project. Very obvious if you're here with us in person. When you leave the worship area, you see that large tree, and it's filled with socks and boots, and we're at about, let's just say, 50% as of, before this morning. I haven't checked. And again, we'd love to fill that tree up with what would be 100 pots of either boots or socks or whatever we gather there. And again, that's a great opportunity for us as well. Another one that many of you would know nothing about, but I heard rave reviews, was that there was, just like a great awakening on Friday. Friday evening, to be specific. What am I talking about? Well, I heard rumors that the best bell ringers ever in Kalamazoo were working at Hobby Lobby, and that happened to be folks from our church. Not only some adults who braved the weather, but I heard about wonderful young people. I could list them by name, all right? But I heard about singing, and I heard about dancing, and I heard that they attracted more people than any bell ringer ever before in the history of humanity, all right? So that is a good thing. That's right. That is a great thing. And so thank you to, again, the adults who kind of arranged that. But thank you, I'm going to say, even a little bit more to the kids who had a lot of fun and just celebrated doing that. And I'm just so thankful for that. And lastly, this morning, I want to have you pay attention to, the goofiness of me, Pastor Paul. As I reflected on the craziness of Christmas, whenever it gets really close to the weekend, we understand that families are busy with Christmas Eve, Christmas Day, and then also Sunday, and we worship. And what do you do? And if you have worship on Christmas Day, and then are people coming on Sunday? And if you have worship Sunday, then do they come Christmas Day and Christmas Eve? Okay? I don't know. And then with, again, gathering, not gathering, and viruses and not viruses, and all that stuff, and we thought, okay, well, we'll do a video, and then people can use that video on Christmas Eve, Christmas Day, and then we'll worship together after Christmas. That left something empty in me. And so what we're going to do is something very different. Many of you have been wonderful about being part of Ash Wednesday Chapel services, where we gather together and we worship for kind of a brief kind of worship service chapel on Ash Wednesday. Well, this year I said, you know what? I want to see people. And I want us to sing those great Christmas songs together. And I want us to be able to just celebrate Christmas is coming. And so you'll see in the park bench, and I'll say it for those of you out there, we are going to have the first ever Christmas Eve chapel. All right? What do I mean? On Wednesday, December 22nd, 6 p.m., Wednesday, 6 p.m., December 22nd, we are going to gather here for a chapel service. We're going to sing the Christmas songs. We're going to focus on the Christmas story. We are going to hopefully have some maybe hot chocolate and some Christmas cookies, who knows what. But we are going to gather, and I don't know if there's going to be two of us, 10 of us, or a million of us. That doesn't matter. What matters is we're going to come together, and we're going to celebrate Christmas, that Christmas is coming down the block, and be together. And so we will record it. We will broadcast it. And so if people can't be part of it, they could use it Christmas Eve or Christmas Day. But we're going to get together Wednesday, December 22nd, first ever Christmas Eve chapel service here. All right? And so I hope you take the time, make that a priority so we can be together. All right, we're going to worship together. And as we think about worshiping together, again, I've been trying to just, think about things that make me smile. And so I have a simple question this morning. And the simple question is this: is anybody in my neighborhood Friday morning? You know where I live? I live right off D Avenue, Rolling Meadows. Anybody driving through the neighborhood? Anybody? No? Just want to make sure. All right. I walked about, 11:30, 12 o'clock. I was walking through the neighborhood. I saw something blowing in the grass. I found $10. Life is good. I'd return it to you, but that's okay. And then I walked a little further, and guess what? I found a quarter. And I walked a little further, and I found another quarter. I'm $10.50 to the good, all right? So again, nobody? Anybody walk in my neighborhood? Yeah, that's what I want, all right? Hey, we're here to worship. So let's welcome each other, wave out there to the camera, everybody out there, and then let's praise God together. Sweetie, how are you?
Of course.
Is that one loaded?
You can hold it on the side.
We hold this starlit night. A king is born in Bethlehem. Our journey long, we seek the light that leads to the hallowed manger ground. Emmanuel.
Isaiah chapter 12. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. The Lord himself is my strength, my defense. He has become my salvation. With joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation. Give praise to the Lord. Shout aloud and sing for joy, people of Zion, for great is the Holy One of Israel among you. Today is a day that we light what is a pink candle, the candle of joy. And we remember the shepherds and how, again, their lives were changed and how they had a message of joy. Some people wonder why do they go to a pink candle on this Sunday? Well, there's a history, and the history is that early on they believed that parents, again, celebrated the birth of a new child with pink decorations, that priests would wear pink vestments to, again, represent the birth of Jesus. And so this candle represents that joy of a birth, the joy of new life, the joy of Jesus coming and the story that the shepherds had to tell. That we would be people of joy, that we would draw from the well of living life with joy, that we would shout and sing for joy in all that we do. Let's pray together. Lord God, are we people of joy? Are we excited about being here? Are we excited about the story of Christmas? Are we excited about this child called Jesus? Lord, need you to speak to us. Need you to, again, live in us and help us to be people of joy. And bring with that hope and celebration into our world. We pray it all in your name. Amen.
Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Look, your king comes to you. He is just and brings salvation. Daughter of Zion, daughter of Jerusalem, that's us, that's the church. May we shout to the north.
Of the great and glorious King, you have
Have a seat. I know that as the praise team heads down, there are some other younger folks. I'm going to get in trouble for saying that. Coming up front. And so I am inviting you guys all up front. And there they come. All right. Yes. Rehearsals always go easily, you know. Dad, you could sit there with them. I love to do that. Hey, buddy. You want to try it? You can sit up front and see what happens. I mean, sit up front there. Whatever you want to do. Oh, well, yeah, we know you want to play the drums, dude. All right? You have got rhythm. You can't be Dutch. No, I'm kidding. All right? So, kids, and like, can you help me with something else right now? Can you listen? I want you to help me with something. Something is coming in a few days. Do you guys know what's coming in a few days?
Christmas! Like
Christmas! Did you know Christmas is coming? Like, did you know that? And Oliver, did you know with Christmas, a lot of things happen. But the biggest thing that happens is smiles. Because everybody's excited about Christmas. That's right. We can ring bells. We can sing songs. We can eat cookies. And we can have fun together. And I just want you guys to help us remember how wonderful Christmas is. So you're going to sing the best way you can sing. And then I think at the end, guess what? You're going to help us sing together. So, all right? So we're going to sing. We're going to try and sing. And we'll do the best we can. Can I give five? Best we can. Best job we can. Best job. Best job. Best job. All right. I'm getting out of the way.
Kiss. them now.
All right, join us on verse 2 and 3, please.
One more.
Before you guys go back down, all right, when I get done talking today, then you can play the drums, okay? When you get done, I got to talk, though. I know it's like da-da-da-da. But before you go, all right, got to remind everybody. Yeah. So help me. Christmas is coming. Can you say it with me, Oliver? Can you say
yeah.
it? Yeah? All right, here we go. So let's practice once. Look at me here. Look at me here. And we're going to, on three, Christmas is coming. Just kind of whisper it once. Ready? One, two, three, Christmas is coming, all right? Now, yeah, now let's say it together. Ready? One, as loud as you can. Will, help me, all right? One, two, three, Christmas is coming. Very good. Thanks for coming up front. As we, first I want to say thank you, all right? Again, all this stuff is kind of like rebooting. Again, we in many ways haven't been together and the kids haven't been together. And so doing these kind of things, good stuff. Parents who are willing to, again, commit to the time, people who are willing to lead, thank you, thank you. Leighton, someday, brother, you're going to be playing drums up here, all right? I want to make that promise to you. But not right now, okay? In a little bit, all right? I promise, in a little bit. I know it's tough, all right? So, God's people and prayers. First of all, one thing I didn't mention when we started worship was that after worship, we have our congregational meeting. And so, those of you that are here and present, please get some coffee, hang out. When the lights flash, we're going to come back in the sanctuary, do a congregational meeting, discuss a lot of stuff. We will record it and tape it, and that way, if somebody out there wants to see what happened and or we can record comments and so forth, we're going to do this together, all right? So just be aware of that congregational meeting, and we need to pray for that as well. Additions to our prayer corner. First of all, Pete Wagoner, many of you know Pete and Marge. Well, Pete had a stroke, and that was a few weeks ago. He spent time in the hospital, spent time Mary Freebed doing some rehab, home now, and still needing to work on that rehab every day. And so remember Pete, and remember Marge as well as they kind of go through that time together. In addition to that, from a little bit further away, shall we say, if you haven't, you need to hear about a lot of the destruction and loss of life in Kentucky from the storms that went through the last couple days. And again, just remember those families and that community that was devastated by tornadoes. And so just need to lift them up and care for them as well. And one thing that I was reminded of in a different kind of way this week, but many of us forget about sacrifices that are made and sacrifices that have impacted our lives. And part of that was reminded with Pearl Harbor Day and the 80th anniversary of that. And just again, remembering those who lost their lives that day, those families that were impacted forever, those who served during World War II, as well as following conflicts, and veterans as a whole, just a time to remember them as well. Again, say thank you if you get the chance. So let's pray together. Lord God, again, we live in a big world with a lot of different people and different ideas. Globally, we are connected so closely now because of, again, technology, and so many things happen. And I just pray, Lord, that as a world, we might be one in this Christmas season. I know that it was many years ago, there was an ad for a Coke commercial teaching the world to sing in perfect harmony. For me, that still rings true, Lord, that in some way we might bring people together. We've been living through a lot of division. We've been living through a lot of divisiveness. And what about coming together? Coming together has happened really many years ago as, again, the world was united in a fight against a enemy. And it was just this idea of superiority. And this country made great sacrifices at Pearl Harbor and further on in the war, as did other countries, Lord, that we might come together in some way and again unite in what is important in making that positive difference, that we might unite as a country as we think about folks in Kentucky and how their lives have been changed forever because of these tornadoes, and right around this holiday season when again everything is supposed to be about joy and about hope and about possibilities, and their lives have been so devastated. I pray, Lord, that even in the midst of that darkness, that you might bring hope, that you might bring comfort, that you might bring peace, and that if we can help do that, Lord, show us how we can do that. Lord, whether it be, again, boxes that we filled at Thanksgiving or boots and socks here at Christmas, that, Lord, people might know that there's someone out there that loves them all the time, and that someone is you. So that when they're at their wits' end, when they least expect it, they might find that connection. And they might find out that it was someone who loved them because God loved them first. Lord, I just thank you for, again, this place called North Park. That even through some of the most difficult times in the history of this country, in the history of church as a whole in this country, and as a church here at North Park, you have been faithful to help us to continue to do ministry, whether it be things like worship here on a Sunday or a chapel service on Ash Wednesday or on Christmas Eve. We've been able to gather in some way, in a new way on the internet, a new way that can bring other people in, a chance, Lord, to be together and care for one another and indeed care for those who you show us, so that we might make that difference. Lord, we think this morning of Pete and ask a blessing upon his rehab. We ask that you'd be with Keith Cahoon as he again continues to heal from COVID. For Vicky as she continues to heal from that knee surgery. Marilyn, as I know she had that hand surgery and that is healing as well. Lord, that you would find that comfort for May Herter as she continues with that loss of her husband, but more importantly at this point, Lord, that she would indeed find that motivation, that Ken would want to give her to get better. That Ken would, again, tell her to get stronger. And again, just to help her in her rehab as well. For Marcia, for Amanda, for others, Lord, that again, your healing hand, your comforting hand would be upon those people. And that again, they might glorify you in all that we do. Lord, I'm just so thankful that we can gather in this place, that again, you continue to bring ministry in this place. Lord, that we're going to gather and have a congregational meeting, and I pray that it might be one of unity, one of production, that we might be able to look forward to what's going to happen in the future and how you will continue to bless this place called North Park in new and different ways, and that we might glorify you in all of that. Thank you for the gifts and for the giving of this congregation, that again, Lord, we might just be blessed in order to be a blessing into the world in which we live. So, Lord, let us continue to worship and celebrate in all that we do. And thank you so much for the gift of community and, again, the gift of being a family of God. We pray all this in your name. Amen. Again, I do want to say thank you, whether or not you're here and you're dropping those gifts off in the plates as you leave, or whether or not you're snail mailing, or if you're doing it online or whatever. You people have been wonderful about keeping a ministry going and, again, impacting our community. And I see that every day. And so thank you for doing that. This morning, we turn in Scripture to Zephaniah chapter 3, verses 14 through 20. Zephaniah chapter 3, verses 14 through 20. Sing. Sing, daughter Zion. Shout aloud, Israel. Be glad and rejoice with all your heart, daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away your punishment. He has turned back your enemy. The Lord, the King of Israel, is with you. Never again will you fear any harm. On that day, they will say to Jerusalem, "Do not fear, Zion. Do not let your hands hang limp. The Lord your God is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing. I will remove from you all who mourn over the loss of your appointed festivals, which is a burden and a reproach for you. At that time, I will deal with all who oppress you. I will rescue the lame. I will gather the exiles. I will give them praise and honor in every land where they have suffered shame. At that time, I will gather you. At that time, I will bring you home. I will give you honor and praise among all people of the earth. When I restore your fortunes before your eyes, says the Lord. Sing, sing, you children of Zion." Over the last few weeks, we've been talking about this idea of watching for the light. Watching for the light. We began with an understanding that in God's time, sometimes we need to wait. And we don't like to wait, and we don't like to reflect. Then last week, we talked about the fact that along with this light comes the challenge of refinement. The challenge that God will use this time of Advent, of Christmas, to challenge us to grow in new ways so that we might reflect more deeply who God is in our lives and how we might serve God. Watching for the light that is Jesus Christ causes us to again take that time to reflect and to be changed by what's going on around us. And this morning, I'd like to simply ask you to look. Look for the colored lights. Look for the colored lights. What do I mean? Well, you know, when you think about Christmas, and again, when you think about all that shines before us on this holiday. Part of it is colored lights. But when I think about colored lights, well, they tend to be, in my mind, a little bit more geared towards children. Don't ask me why, but for me, when I think about those white lights, I think about kind of that classic look. I grew up in a neighborhood, in an area with a lot of Frank Lloyd Wright houses with clean lines. And people would take those lines and they would light them up with perfect white lights. It's very adult. It's very ordered. It's very classic. It's very sterile. But colored lights, now that's all about kids. And if you add that flashing bulb and they go on and they go off, wow, now that is something that kids are attracted to, something that bubbles up joy inside of us. How about it this morning? Do you have that spirit in you of Christmas as a child? I mean, do you remember baking those Christmas cookies, those Christmas treats? In my mind, I can still see myself sitting at the kitchen counter with my mom, with my grandmother, and they would hand me the bag of walnuts, and I would fill it in that little chopper, and I'd screw the lid on, and I'd stand there, and I'd punch that top, and punch that top, and punch that top, until those walnuts were just perfect for the Christmas cookies at hand. Or maybe it was decorating. The joy of knowing that when Christmas was coming, the decorations came out. The colored lights came out. My joy, my biggest joy, was setting up the Christmas village on the mantle in our house. The church, the houses, the colored lights that went inside of each of those buildings. The little lead people on their sleds, on their skis, on their ice skates. The mirror that we used to cover in fake foam so it looked like they were skating on ice. Do you remember, like a child, what it's like to get ready for Christmas? Wrapping the presents, going to church. Do you remember, as I do, getting an orange and a candy bar at Christmas from my Sunday school teacher? Those memories, those sights, those sounds, those smells of Christmas and Christmas joy. And ultimately, what about Santa Claus? That's right. Do you remember that? Santa's coming. Santa's coming, and so we put the milk and the cookies out. We're waiting for Santa to arrive and bring with him all of those amazing presents. The excitement inside to hear the reindeer, to hear the story told. But I also want to ask you this morning, when did you stop believing in Santa? Take a minute. Do you remember when you stopped believing in Santa Claus? For me, it was early on because I'm the youngest in my family. And I have older siblings who ruined it a lot quicker for me. Am I right? You know, we youngest children, we lose out on so much. And one of those things is being told that, well, you know, it's just not real. When did you stop believing in Santa? But as I thought about that, there was another question. One that scared me even more. And that's this question. Can you remember what it was like to believe in Santa? I realize that I've gotten so old that I really don't remember what it was like to believe in Santa. I mean, that whole naughty nice thing and trying to make it on the right list, the whole idea of again, all the traveling that Santa did, the hope that came in, the gifts that were possibilities, that inside feeling of, wow, Santa. I can't remember what it's like to feel that childhood feeling of the joy of Christmas, that Santa is coming down that chimney. Do you remember it? You see, Santa interrupted our world. As little children, Santa interrupted our world, our year. Regardless of what was going on, when Christmas came, Santa was coming and things got interrupted. Things were changed. Even if things weren't good at home, even if I wasn't feeling well, even if things weren't good at school, when Santa was coming, life got interrupted and joy came down that chimney. But as adults, we're taught not to believe. We're taught that it's just a fable. And over the course of 10, 20, 30, 50, whatever many years it might be, we are programmed to not believe. No chimney, no Santa, no interruption of our world. And so our world is one that's filled with unrest and discord, a world that's filled with class struggle, jealousy, racism, hate. The list goes on. Ultimately, our world that's filled with darkness, and there is no interruption. There is no Santa. There are no colored lights. We get stuck. And there is no joy. The passage that we read from Zephaniah is a song. Again, I stressed it, the first word being sing. It's a song of joy. It's a song of light returning to the people of Israel. It is God telling his people that they will be interrupted, that their world will be interrupted by the presence of God in their lives. And with that, God will usher in a new song, a new day, and that day will be filled with joy. Emmanuel, God with us. When Jesus comes down, not through a chimney, but Jesus comes down to interrupt our world, to interrupt the darkness, to interrupt the unrest, the discord, the racism, the jealousy. Again, that darkness is broken because of the light. And with that light comes great joy. Great joy that brings a smile. Great joy that brings a song. Great joy that brings hope. And so this morning, the question is the same. Do you believe? Do you believe like a child? Do you have childlike faith that Scripture speaks of, in which you believe that this child, this Christ child, has come to interrupt our world? And in interrupting our world, bring joy, to bring colored lights into our life and our existence. As you read this passage, you see that when Jesus comes, there is no more fear. It doesn't matter what takes place on this earth, because we know we are children of a family that celebrates this Christmas. And in the light, we know that there is hope above all else. And so fear does not reign. Not only is there no more fear, but there is restoration. That regardless of where you have been, regardless of the struggles that you might have been going through, regardless of the stumbling we may have done, God wants to restore us. Because of the power of this child, because of the brightness and color of the light, there is restoration in our lives. There is justice. Justice. Not our idea of justice. Not the Supreme Court ruling, but justice in the eyes of God, where the children of God are brought forward and forth into the future. And God brings home the children who he has called. And we are attracted to the light of this child that has come into the earth, Emmanuel, God with us. It's Jesus coming that gets rid of the fear, that brings restoration, that brings justice, and brings aid and healing to the poor. Not just the poor as we might define it, but the poor in spirit as well. That in this moment of Christ coming down, of God interrupting our world, there is aid for each of us so that we might overcome whatever the darkness has placed upon us. It's an interruption of our adult world. An interruption that says it can be different. An interruption that says there is hope. An interruption that brings a song to our heart so that we might sing and be filled with the joy that is Christ Jesus, our living God. Do you remember what it's like to believe? You remember what it's like to believe like a child? Childlike faith? Do you believe in this child? In the child, Son of God? Where God in his infinite wisdom said, it's time to interrupt the adult world and say, there is hope, there is possibility, there is love, there is grace, there is joy. If we believe. The colored lights, the flashing lights, the sights, the smells of Christmas. It's an interruption that says, stop for a minute. Don't listen to the world anymore. Celebrate, smile, laugh. Jesus is God's interruption to all of us adults who have stopped believing, saying, believe. Believe that I've come to change things. Believe that I've come to heal. Believe that I've come to make you strong. Believe that I've come to let you know you are loved. Believe that you are supposed to have a song to sing and joy in your heart. Today is a new day. Believe. God sent Jesus to interrupt our world. Do you believe? Amen. Lord God, thank you for this, your word. Whether it be the people of Israel, whether it be the prophet of Zephaniah, you have come so that we might live, so that we might have life. And we might have life abundantly. As adults, we let so many things get in the way. And yet you sent your son to interrupt all of that so that we might see the colored lights, so that we might hear the song and melody in our heart, so that we might have joy because we are children of God. Lord, help us so that we might believe. In your name, amen. Please stand and receive a blessing. As you go from this place into an adult world, are you ready to be interrupted? Are you ready to be reminded of the love of God the Father who has chased you from the beginning of time, screaming, "I love you," at every turn? Are you ready to be interrupted with this child, Jesus, the Savior, where God again sent his son down into our world so we might believe in that love? And may you go with the beautiful, flashing, colored lights of the Holy Spirit to remind you of the joy, the song, the celebration, the power of God at work in your life. I pray this day that we would believe, that we would welcome the interruption, and that we would have a song to sing because of it. From now until forevermore, amen.
Let there be peace.